Behalf of ELAN, the English Literary Association of Navya Kanya Mahavidyalaya, I extend a very warm welcome to all those who are on this platform today, but especially our guest speaker, Professor Gaurahari Behra, who's from Deen Dayal Upadhyay University, Gorakhpur. He's from Department of English. And today he'll be speaking on understanding post-colonial identities. And we are looking forward to his lecture, and we are very pleased and honored to host him today in this lecture series. And then last but not the least, I welcome our principal, Dr. Srishti Srivastava, who is here, and despite her busy schedule, she takes out time to encourage and motivate us with her presence. So I would request her to speak a few words. Please, ma'am. Dr. Srishti Srivastava, ma'am, are you there? Ma'am, please put your video on and unmute yourself. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Sangeeta. Today, some connectivity issue. I'm on the way. Namaskar. On behalf of Navya Kanya Mahavidyalaya, I, Dr. Srishti Srivastava, welcome you all. I'm impressed to see the topic, and I'm sure that Dr. Gaurahari will give us some insight regarding this topic. I don't know much about regarding this topic, but I'm sure that I'll get some insight with her.
Ma'am, you are audible.
I want to congratulate Department of English for organizing such type of lectures for our students and faculty members. Dr. Seema Sarkar, Dr. Sangeeta Kotwal, and all faculty members are very vibrant and very intelligent, and they are committed to the department. I congratulate you all, and I welcome again Dr. Gaurahari on behalf of our W family.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, our principal, ma'am, Srishti. Thank you so much for taking so much of time while going on the way also. That is very motivating, very inspiring for us. And now it is the customary to introduce to all of you our guest speaker, Professor Dr. Gaurahari Behra. He is a professor in the Department of English, Deen Dayal Upadhyay, Gorakhpur University, Gorakhpur. He has 22 years of teaching, and he specializes in literary criticism and theory, post-colonial literatures and aesthetics. And he has co-edited two collections of essays. First title is Representation and Resistance, Essays in Post-Colonial Theater and Drama. Then second one is Literatures of South Asia. And let me tell you that I am also got an honor that I have also one article published in that book. Very much insistence by Dr. Behrada. Then he is also the author of Contemporary Indian Literary Criticism, Alternative Frameworks. He has 8 successful PhDs supervised by him till date. And above all, a very interesting thing about him is that he is the founder of Episteme, that is a forum for interdisciplinary studies in humanities.
Now, let me tell you very, very interesting thing that because he specializes in particularly post-colonialism, that's why it was an insistence and very, very deep request to him to present this lecture for the benefit of our students. So I welcome you, Dr. Gaur Hari Behrada, on the platform of Zoom on our college, that is Navya Kanya Mahavidyalaya. Welcome, Dada.
Thank you, Seema. Thank you.
Good, Dalia.
Shall we start the lecture?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes,
definitely.
Thank you. At the outset, I would thank the entire college for inviting me for this lecture. The principal, the organizing committee, and I'm in touch with Dr. Seema Sarkar for a long time, and she was kind enough to invite me for this lecture, which is an honor for me. And when she called me up and said that you say speak something on post-colonialism, the target audience happens to be mostly students. So I thought that what initially I thought of speaking something on, let's say, post-colonial criticism as such. But I thought that some basic ideas about post-colonial thing will be better. And this lecture is not restricted to post-colonial literature as such. This this has a larger canvas in the sense that we all are concerned in our daily lives. We are very concerned about the identities and identities. We are prisoners of our identities. So we always are, we always are busy asserting who we are. So I begin with, let's say, by talking about what actually do we mean by identity, and then go on to talk about post-colonial identities. Now I'll share the screen with you. Just a minute. Can you see the screen now?
Not yet.
Okay, just a minute.
Earlier it was visible when you tried it, but right now it's not visible.
Just a second.
Yes, right now. Right, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Now, the topic is something called understanding post-colonial identities. So we begin by actually trying to define what identity is. Now, identity in very general terms would mean a person's sense of the self. Is the answer to the question, who am I? And that actually is what identity is all about. When you start asking who you are, okay, and that prompts, that is the trigger where the whole question of identity, identity politics, all this comes about. Now, who we are, that there are many theorizations about in philosophy, in literature, and many other social sciences. There are lots of debates about who we are actually. So when we look at these views and try to summarize them, we essentially have two views about identity. One is called the essentialist view and the other is called the discursive view. Now, the essentialist view believes that identity is something that is inside us. It resides in us as an essence, unchanging essence. And in the sense that we have something called an identity right from the beginning, that who we are. And that transcends our social and environmental influences. That is something like a pure kind of thing which is inside us, which gives us our identity. And it has its basis, some common origin or shared characteristics with people or a group of people. And it is beyond, it is not dependent on our environmental influences. And it cannot be transformed. That, you know, if your identity is once it is fixed, it is fixed. Okay. So for example, if you are your identity is an Indian, you are an Indian, finish. That is Indian. So that is, you are born in India, so you're an Indian. So that Indianness is something which gives you the identity of being an Indian. Okay. Or let's say religious identity, if you look at it, if you are a Hindu, for example, that is it. You are a Hindu. And naturally, that Hindu-ness is what defines you as your identity as a Hindu, for example. So this is the essentialist view, that it is something secure inside us, okay, and it transcends all kind of influences, okay, unchanging. But there is another view. With postmodernism comes another view, which is called the discursive view. Now, the discursive view says that identity is actually a construction. That identity is not something which is inside us. You know, it gets constructed. Okay, and it is not only a construction, it is a process. And it is endlessly redefined in the sense that, you know, you don't have a fixity of any kind. You know, your identity is redefined according to circumstances in which you are placed. So it is endlessly redefined. It is never complete. You cannot say that, you know, that this is my identity forever. Once an identity, the identity is forever. It is never complete. It always goes on changing your identity. So that's why it's not fixed. It is not something which is there. It is not fixed. And that's why you have to establish your identity again and again and again and again and again. That means your identity changes because it is get constructed because of different discourses. As we say, that's why it is discursive view. Very different discourses construct one's identity according to different circumstances. This is the discursive view. So there are two very important theoreticians or theory who actually talk about this discursive view, which has a tremendous influence on, let's say, post-colonialism or post-colonial identities. One is a Caribbean theoretician whose name is Stuart Hall. Now, Stuart Hall believes, he's a cultural theorist, he believes that we possess a myriad of different cultural identity positions from a multiplicity of sources. That means, that is, identity is not something one, you know, it has different sources. And different cultural identity positions, that means identity is not something which is an essence, it is a position that you take somewhere. Okay, so when your position changes, your positioning changes, so your identity too changes. So identity can be, it can stem from nationality, it can stem from ethnicity, race, class, language, gender, sexuality, all these contribute to what we call our identity. And identity cannot be defined in terms of one shared culture or something. For example, that, one shared culture, I can't define myself as one Indian because, that Indianness is shared by so many people. Okay. Thus, that means cultural identity or any kind of identity, let's say, because cultural identity, I'm saying because post-colonialism is very specific about this whole idea of cultural identity. So cultural identity is not something very stable. Okay, it is unstable and it is continually shifting. It is continually shifting. This is what Stuart Hall says, that the stability of our identities is a myth. There can be no stable identity. And because it always continually shifts, it is a shifting kind of a thing. And that is why it is like a fluid. Just like you can't, you know, the fluid can't stay fixed. It flows. Okay, similarly, our identity is also, you know, in a fluid state. It flows all the time. So when you are saying that your identity is fluid, so the whole idea of a essentialist kind of a identity is actually a myth. It cannot be there in that sense of the term. A single fixed identity is actually a myth, according to Stuart Hall. So similarly, we all know about Homi Bhabha, very famous post-colonial theorist. So he says that we are all characterized by what we call in the post-colonial situations. We are all characterized by cultural hybridity. Okay, cultural hybridity means that it's a mixture of cultural fragments. We are all constituted by many cultural fragments, including nationality, race, religion, gender, everything. We are all, so we are a mixture of many, let's say, fragments. And our identity is a mixture of many fragments. Okay. And this post-colonial subject, I'm using the word subject instead of individual, because we are subjected to many such discourses. Okay. Nationality, race, religion, color, you know, gender, sexuality, all these things. He is assaulted by multiple historical and cultural and political forces. And when you are assaulted, you try to appropriate all the, consciously or unconsciously, we appropriate several identities. Okay. And that's why Bhabha, like Stuart Hall, he rejects the notions of a fixed, rooted, or something called the original identity. That is, we have the habit of saying that I'm an originally, let's say, when somebody asked me, because I stay in UP, so then they see my surname and they say that, where are you from originally? Then I say that I am originally from Odisha. But this whole idea of original is actually a myth, because you see, I have appropriated so many things, okay, from, let's say, by after saying 22 years in Uttar Pradesh, yeah, I have become, you know, more of a UPI than an Odia in that sense of it. But that whole idea of original identity, which is actually, you know, we try to connect with, is actually a myth. Okay, because identity in a post-colonial context, because, you know, post-colonialism is, let's say, associated with lot of movement, okay, lot of mobility. We have moved from many places. We are no more staying in a particular place where we are born and we die there. We have all moved. And all this movement, this mobility, has actually brought us in contact with many cultures, okay, many way of living. So that means identity is a process of negotiating. You negotiate with many cultures, okay, and you articulate your, let's say, identity. So identity in a post-colonial context is a process of negotiation. You negotiate with many cultures. And that is why it is not a fixed, it is not rooted anywhere. And this is what the whole idea of post-colonial identities is all about. Okay, now, let's, you know, I'll just give you a very, let's say, easy example that we, from our day-to-day life. Okay, we all believe, let's say, that each of us belong to one religion, one linguistic community, a single culture, or a unique civilization. We believe in all these things, isn't it? We believe that our identity is something, let's say, defined by a membership to a particularly mutually exclusive group. Okay. For example, if we are Bengali, for example, then we cannot be Odia or Assamese, in that sense. Okay. Or if we are a Hindu, we cannot be a Muslim or a Christian. Okay. We believe in these things. But in reality, if you see, then you see that multiple belongings is a common in a post-colonial situation, because we imbibe from other cultures. Okay, we imbibe from that. This fluidity, in understanding who we are, that is our identity, is one of the significant features of post-colonialism. Okay, take for instance a person who stays in Delhi. I studied in Delhi, for example, that's why. So take for instance, who someone is staying in Delhi. Now he has inherited a multiple streams. For example, in terms of languages, in multiple streams of Hindi, Urdu, Punjabi. Okay. Now those who speak these languages, Hindi, Urdu, or Punjabi, they do not realize that the many words that they speak actually, okay, they are from different origins. Okay. For example, Arabic origin, for example. For example, the word Admi, for example, okay, Malik, for example, they are from Arabic origin, for example. For example, monuments that you see in Delhi, for example, Humayun Tomb and all those things, they are not from, you know, they don't belong to one particular culture. Okay, there are many, many, many streams that go. The cuisines that we eat, Lucknow is very good as, you know, cuisine hub in sense. So the cuisines that we have in our day-to-day lives, you know, they are also shaped by, you know, by many cultures. Okay, the taste, the sensibility are all, you know, they are all produced by intersecting cultures. So intersecting cultures. So identity, so the identities that they shape, okay, are all not only something which is fixed. Okay, that's why they are all, you know, we imbibe from different cultures. So naturally, it is very unwise to say that we have something called a fixed kind of a culture. So in post-colonial situation, a fixity of culture is also a very, we are all shaped by, let's say, when it comes to religion, for example, we are shaped by multiple strands of, let's say, Hinduism, Islam, Christianity, all these things, Sikhism, understand? You know, for example, you see, I can't call myself a complete in that sense, Hindu in that sense, because in me, I find many strands of Islam and Christianity is a part of my existence. Okay, all of us, we do. So just only, you know, privileging one identity over the other, okay, is again a very, very, dangerous act. Why? Because exclusivity creates a lot of tensions in that between. Okay, exclusive, you know, this kind of exclusivity, the idea of exclusive belonging to any one of these, whether in terms of linguistic identity, in terms of religious identity, in terms of cultural identity, okay, is to actually be, you know, either you are ignorant about all these things or you try to deny that part of the culture which actually is a part of you. Okay, so we try to deliberately deny it. Okay, most of us, let's say, celebrate birthdays in the house by cutting cakes and having candles and all those things, which is not part of our Hindu tradition. Okay, but it is a part of our existence. Okay, so I can't deny the fact that I'm equally a part of that tradition and culture. As good as being a Hindu or something like that. So this kind of exclusive belonging. So we belong, you know, exclusive to one culture, exclusive to one religion, exclusive to one language is actually very undesirable. Okay, it is very unfeasible also because our overall identity is far more complex, okay, and far more multi-layered than what we articulate. Okay, just to take the apparent or a manifest, let's say, part of ourselves as our single identity is to accept a very narrow view of identity, very truncated view of identity. Okay. And that's why, and it is undesirable too, because that actually creates conflict. Okay, so in order to substantiate this whole idea that there cannot be a single fixed culture, you know, identity, because identities in a post-colonial situation is very, very multi-layered and it is not fixed. It is a very fluid kind of a thing. Okay. I would like to substantiate this whole idea by taking two literary texts, because we are in literature departments. So two texts we will try to see to show that how post-colonial literature try to deal with the whole idea of identity. Okay, and these two texts are, one is a novel and the other is a play. Now, there is a very interesting novel by Michael Ondaatje called The English Patient, which has been filmed also. Now, if you look at the screen, you will see that this novel is set at the almost at the end of the Second World War. Okay. And the setting is a place in a ruined Italian villa. Okay. And there are four very important characters. Okay. Almazi, who is the English patient, as the title of the novel suggests. Then we have a nurse called Hannah. We have a character called Kip, whose actually his name is Kirpal Singh, who is an Indian Sikh. And there is a character called Karavaju. Now, all these characters you will see, they all have multiple identities. Okay, they have all multiple identities. Now you see the first character, Almazi. Now, Almazi is referred to as the English patient. But actually, he is not an Englishman. He is, in fact, is an Hungarian expatriate turned citizen of the world who does not have any specific national identity. Okay. And he tries to actually reject and elude the forces of nationality by staying in a desert. Now, a desert is a place where there is no nationality in that sense. Okay. Where he tries to create an alternate identity for himself. Okay. A kind of identity, one in which family and nation are irrelevant. Okay, he constructs his identity through his character, work, and interactions with others. That means he does not inherit a kind of identity. We all believe that we have inherited some kind of identity. I am an Indian because my father was Indian in that sense. Okay, so we inherit identity. He does not inherit any identity. He chooses his own identity. Okay, says Almazi. So in fact, very interestingly, you will find that Almazi, although he is called the English patient, at the end of the novel, we'll find that he is not even English. So the whole idea of nationality and national culture dissolves, okay, in this novel. And you know, Ondaatje tries to show that you know this in such a scenario, you know, this the whole idea of identity is not fixed. Okay, one chooses one own identity wherever he goes. Okay, and similarly, the most interesting character is a character called Kirpal Singh. Now, who is called Kip in this novel? Now, right from the beginning, he shows a kind of alienation from his birth. He rejects the family traditions. So he joins the British army instead of the Indian army. In that sense, he joins the British army. He finds a family in the bomb disposal squad where the commander becomes a kind of a father, and the commander is not an Indian in that sense. Okay. He has his, you know, he rechristens himself as Kip. Okay. And he loves all things which are English in that sense. He has a typical English, although he is his name is Kirpal Singh. He's an Indian, he's a Sikh. Okay. He is a lover of all things English. Okay. So he constructs his identity through his expertise, through his technical knowledge, through his courage. So these are the ways by which he constructs his identity. These identities are very important for him. These are the markers of his identity. The markers of his identity are not his nationality, but his work, his, let's say, his technological knowledge, his courage. You know, later he joins the sappers in the Italian campaign and all these things. So you see, Kirpal Singh is a character who is a typical example of a post-colonial, subject who actually... let's say, has multiple identities in this sense, multiple identities. So that's why Almazi, that character, says that I and Kip are international bastards. Okay, here the bastard word is not used in a negative sense, international bastards in the sense that we do not have any fixed kind of, you know, let's say, inheritance or anything. We are international bastards. Okay, so that is one very... very pertinent quote in the novel, which sums up the whole idea of post-colonial identity. Okay, the characters in this novel, you know, they represent a post-national conception of identity. We are all international bastards. Okay, that is the boundaries, the national boundaries have just dissolved, and in such a post-national situation, okay, the identity, the national identities and all these things are immaterial. But at the end of the novel, we see Kip begins to assert his national identity later on. Okay, because he is shocked by the bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and he tries to reassert a nice kind of nationalist agenda. But that again is again another issue altogether. But the whole issue is that what Michael Onzardi tries to show in this novel is that the whole idea of nationalism, the whole idea of identity, and especially nationalist identity or national identity, is not something which is there in us. Okay, it's not something. It is constructed. It is constructed, and it is subject to change. It is subject to transformation. It is subject to dissolution. And that's why the whole idea of fixity of national identity, the aura about national identity that we cherish so much, and we are proud of such kind of national identity, is actually a construct, and it is a construction as its own politics. Okay, this is even the character Caravaggio, for example. Okay, he is a spy. Now you all know that a spy does not have a fixed identity. He changes his identity again, and his whole existence is based on his changing identities. So you see that he's a spy. He was spying in the Second World War, and spies don't have any a fixed identity. So you see all these characters that we see in this novel, in my own Dutch novel, okay, none of them actually have a kind of a fixed identity. They are all imbibed. They have all imbibed, multiple identities. Okay, so this is the through this novel we see that how one such novel tries to capture the whole idea of post-colonial identity is this novel. Okay, then again you see another question that comes up, especially in a post-colonial situation, is that where does our identity reside? Okay, where should we look for our identity? Okay, because a post-colonial situation is preceded by colonialism. And we all know that the colonialism has actually, if you look at Fanon and all these people, it has actually, what it has done is that it has assaulted our psyche in such a manner that we fail to actually ground ourselves in any kind of identities. So one way of looking at identity is that, as theoreticians and some people believe, that our real identities are actually in the pre-colonial past. It is somewhere before the colonizers came, we were a very pure kind of identity, but colonialism, okay, it destroyed that kind of a thing. So our real identities are both, our real identity can be found somewhere in the pre-colonial past, before the colonization took place, because that was the place where actually something kind of a pure identity was taken. Okay, so now, in order to substantiate this, there is a very interesting play by Derek Walcott, Dream on Monkey Mountain. Now, it is Derek Walcott's masterpiece, and it provides deep insights into the West Indian sense of crisis. Walcott is a Nobel Prize winner, he's a poet, he's a dramatist, okay? And he belongs to an island called St. Lucia, okay, which is a Caribbean island. And Derek Walcott himself, as he's from his grandfather's, paternal grandfather's side, he was black, and maternal grandmother's side, he was white. Okay, so he has a mixed heritage, genetically mixed heritage he has, culturally mixed heritage, because he is a product of so many cultures, because he studied in England. Okay, originally they're Africans, okay, and studied in England, and he kind of a mixed heritage. If you look at his poem called A Far Cry from Africa, he says that I who am poisoned with the blood of both, in the saying that, in my culture, in my identity, there is a mixed kind of a culture. Okay, and now on Dream on Monkey Mountain, he says that this play, it dramatizes the impossibility of locating one's identity in terms of binaries. Binaries in the sense either this, you are this or this, as if there are no other options. But there are many options of your identity. So it is impossible to locate either you are British or you are, let's say non-British. Either you are this or that. So these binaries, it does not help in actually establishing our own ethos. That means, you know, he says that, you know, if you look at the, that play, I just narrate, I summarize that play to you, that there is a, let's say, the character, the chief character of the play is a person called Makak. Now, he is an old, ugly looking charcoal burner, okay? And he has lived in a mountain, on a mountain called the Monkey Mountain all his life, okay? And one night, he dreams. Now he dreams, and in that dream, a white goddess appears, you know? And a white goddess, just, you know, I'm emphasizing on the word white. The white goddess appears, okay? And she declares, she tells Makak in the dream, that you are the direct descendant of African kings, okay? And you are the savior of the African race. So why are you spending your time here? You should go to Africa. Now, Makak takes this very seriously in the dream. He feels very empowered because he thinks that, you know, that is, I am the savior of the African race. So he, along with his friend Mustik, they start a journey, a mythical journey in that dream itself. You know, they start a journey towards Africa. Okay. Now, what happens is that Makak is jailed because there is a market riot in which his friend Mustik is killed, and he is held responsible for this kind of a riot, and he is jailed by a colonel called Colonel Restrict. Now, what happens is that he escapes. He escapes from that jail, okay, along with two more prisoners, okay, and starts, he sets off for Africa to claim his kingship, okay. And but that Colonel Lestrade follows him, and during that following, at the foot of the mountain, Colonel Restrade, you know, gets some revelation. He experiences a revelation that leads him to accept his blackness, because he is black in color, his blackness, okay. And Makak starts rethinking about his journey towards Africa, okay. Now, what happens is that finally, at the end of the play, Makak abandons his journey, okay, to go to Africa, because he realizes that it is impossible to recover that Africa, the old, the pristine Africa. It is no more possible. That's why it is impossible, okay, to return to a pure African roots, okay, because if you do that, number one, as Stuart Hall says, that it is not possible, because you see, that pure Africa is no more. History is not reversible, okay? And again, accepting the colonial heritage is also problematic, okay? And going back to a pure African origin is also problematic, because, because you see that going back to that pure African is again a colonial construct, because who gives that idea? The white goddess. The white goddess actually represents the colonial power. So this whole idea that we have our own identity, pure identity in a pre-colonial times, is actually a colonial construct. It is colonialism which has given this the idea that our identity lies somewhere in the past. Okay, somewhere, you know, pure identity lies somewhere in the past. So it's a return to Africa is impossible, because the original Africa or the original pre-colonial society is no more there. It has been transformed. Okay. So that means what Walcott does in this play is that Walcott tries to posit a very hybrid kind of identity as the authentic identity, whether it is a Caribbean identity or post-colonial identity. So what is post-colonial identity? Post-colonial identity is not something identity which you go back to the past, as nativists would like to say. Nativists try to say that our culture or our heritage is somewhere which is there in the past, in the sense that pre-colonial past is what defines us. But it is impossible to go to that pre-colonial past where everything has changed. And we don't have any guarantee that the pre-colonial past is actually the authentic identity. Okay, so it is impossible. So identity is not something which is there at the past or something like that. Identity is all about positioning. What is your position here now? Okay, vis-a-vis the colonialism and present circumstances. Okay, so that means in this play also we find that the whole idea of post-colonial identity is problematized. Okay, post-colonial literature, post-colonial performance tries to problematize the whole idea of identities or post-colonial identities. They try to problematize that, identity is not something which is very simple, that you can locate it somewhere here or somewhere there. It is a very, complex phenomenon. It is a product of a process. Okay, it's a process. It has a product of a positioning. Okay, and we position ourselves vis-a-vis many other discourses. Okay, at the same time. So naturally, having a single kind of a fixed identity. Okay, somewhere in the past or somewhere in the future, whatever. Okay, that is not a feasible kind of identity. It is better that we accept our multiple identities. And this acceptance of these multiple identities is actually empowering. Okay, it is empowering because, just being nostalgic about some kind of a pure past is actually does not help us, because that only leaves us frustrated and nothing else. So it is better to accept the identity that we are all a mixed kind of a identity. Our identities are all mixed. Okay, we have inherited many things from many cultures, many gender, sexuality, and all those things. So having a single kind of identity is not possible. So post-colonial literature, for example, if you see the diasporic literature also, all these diasporic literature try to do the same thing. Okay, you can't have a single, a kind of identity that you are an Indian or an American. Because as Bhabha says that, identity is constructed in the in-between spaces. Okay, that is where the, in diasporic literature, we find that our identity is constructed somewhere in the in-between spaces. Okay, somewhere in the threshold. Okay, not in one country or the other country, somewhere in between. And that is very empowering. Okay, that actually is the source of creativity. Okay, all our creativity lies where? In that in-between spaces. Okay, where we accept our identity as something which is hybridized. Okay, which is, and there is nothing to be ashamed of this hybridization, because that is empowering, that is less dangerous. Because having an exclusive identity in terms of nation, in terms of culture, in terms of language, has its own problems. Okay, it generates violence. We become intolerant of others. Okay, because if I think that I'm exclusively a Hindi-speaking country, a Hindi-speaking individual, I may start hating other religion and look down upon other languages. Okay, so this kind of things, having a pure kind of identity, is a myth. And post-colonial literature tries to actually problematize the whole issue of this identity. Okay, so if you look at identities in terms of all these things, we will find that post-colonial literature is very, very empowering. Empowering in the sense it gives you the freedom and it to choose your own identity. Okay, you don't inherit identities, you choose identities. Okay, and that is very empowering. And that is why post-colonial literature in these terms are very empowering in that sense. Okay, so there are many other examples we will find, especially West Indian literature, okay, African literature, Canadian, and even in Indian writing in English also, you will find that this whole question of identity, multiple identities, all these things are very well discussed, okay, in fiction, in plays, even in poetry, okay, and that's why this issue of post-colonial identities is what I thought would be a better, let's say, way of introducing the question of identity to students, okay, and I think I need to stop here. If there are any questions, you can ask. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Behera, for a very enlightening, very nice lecture.
Thank you.
I'm sure the student must be asking some questions. Seema, are there any questions?
Right now, though, I cannot see. So just I'm checking in the that YouTube also. Just check and let me.
If you allow.
Yes, Sankalp, carry on.
Yeah. Good evening, sir.
Thank you.
It was a very nice lecture that you delivered on post-colonialism. My question is slightly related, and it is based on the concept of culture. Mm. As you mentioned about Stuart Hall, so he also quoted that culture is a dynamic process. It cannot be stagnant. And as you quoted that, when we create about the identities, so it is made in between. So how a culture impacts an identity? What is your take on this? If we talk about post-colonial literature or maybe criticism, so does it influence the identity or does it mediate? How does it work? As in, what is your take on this?
You see, as I said, that identity is not something which is there in us. Okay, identities are always constructed. Okay, and naturally, it is constructed when, let's say, when you imbibe, different kinds of things from different kinds of cultures. Okay, so cultures naturally have a culture is one such discourse which constructs our identity. Okay, for example, culture. What is culture? Culture is a way of living. And I will give you my own example. Okay, that, you know, I belong to a particular state called Odisha. Okay, and I stay in UP. The cultural thing are very different from the cultural matrix that I come from. Okay, now at present, I just cannot claim myself to be a complete, you know, culturally a complete Odia in that sense of it. You see, because I hardly speak Odia in my house or let's say in my workplace or whatever it is. I speak mostly Hindi in that sense of it. I have started liking, the food of this place. Okay, these are all Parkar. So my identity is actually constructed when it comes in contact with, the UP culture. But again, that UP culture is not a UP, it's not a singular culture. Again, it is a culture of many streams, for example. Many kinds of streams come into the theory. So you say you cannot have a pure kind of a UP culture or a pure kind of a Odia culture that I can claim to be a kind of a thing. So naturally, what I do is that when a person comes in contact with other cultures, he tries to negotiate with other cultures. Okay, he doesn't. Because there is something. I come from a different. I don't start fighting with your culture. No, I try to negotiate with your culture. Okay, right. This is what negotiation. So culture is a process of negotiation. And you know, negotiation is very interesting in the sense that in the process of negotiation, there is always a give and take. Okay, so it's not, you know, the give and take always takes, you know, I have given so much of ideas and, you know, cultural matrix to my neighbors who are Hindi speaking people, and I have also imbibed so many things. Now we have a different kind of a culture, let's all together. This is how, that is how culture actually is in relation to your identity. Cultures constructs identities, and we negotiate with that kind of identities all day. This is what I basically wanted.
Okay, thank you so much, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, sir, there is a question from Asmita Sharma. She is a student from MA. Her question is, As you said, that essentialist view is just a myth. So can we say that identity can be changed and it's not stagnant?
Yeah, exactly. Okay, essentialist view is a myth because what our practice, in practice, what we see is actually that we see that there is no such essential kind of identity inside us. Okay, as I have already given you an example. Okay, so naturally, identity is not something which is very stagnant. That once I am born a particular, in a particular culture or a particular nation, I mean, that is again fixed. Although we, while filling up the forms and everything, although we write all these things, that what is your religion and all these things, in real practice also, you see that our identity is not very stagnant. It is not very, let's say, stable. It is always, let's say, changing. So when it is changing, so naturally, the essentialist view of identity is completely, demolished. It is completely demolished because when I'm living in a particular situation, I let's say manifest many cultural identities, many kind of identities. So that is, and these identities are again constructed. Okay. Essentialist view does not believe in the construction of identity. It believes that the identity is already there, which is fixed. Wherever you go, we go to England, you go to America, you are always an Indian. It is not always so. We try to cover it up by saying that we are always Indian. But you're officially an Indian in that sense of the term. But culturally, in practice, you are not. Okay, you imbibe so many cultures. So naturally, the essentialist view is demolished. It is a myth because, essentialist view believes that identity is stagnant. Whereas identity is always dynamic. It is always in process and it is always like a fluid. It always flows. And that is why the discursive view of identity is a much more viable kind of option than, let's say, the essentialist.
Okay, thank you, sir. Sir, there is another question.
Sure.
If multiple identities is the reality of postmodernism and it is empowering, then how post-colonialism problematizes the concept identity?
Yeah, okay. Problematizes in the sense that post-colonial literature tries to question and interrogate those ideas of identity which believe that your identity is something which actually is stagnant and which is not liable to change. It is somewhere fixed, somewhere in the past. And post-colonial literature tries to interrogate all these things. It tries to give you an alternative to all these things. Saying that, you see, whatever, for example, I gave you the example of this dream on Monkey Mountain. In Dream of Monkey Mountain, Macaque believes that my African identity is somewhere in the past. Okay. Somewhere in the past, my African identity, and I can reclaim that identity if I go back to the past. Now, post-colonial, Derek Walcott, as a post-colonial writer, tries to interrogate this by saying that, you see, it is no more possible to go back. Okay, that is why he problematizes. He says that in the past, how do you know that that is the past, that is the pure past? How do you know? Mm-hmm. How do you know that this is unadulterated? You have no idea because history cannot be reversed. So it tries to problematize the whole issue of that. Even in the English patient also, you see, these people do not have any nationality. Okay, so it problematizes our national identity because we are all obsessed with national identities. Okay, but it tries to say that, you see, our national identities are also not very fixed because if you land up in a desert, okay, and who defines your identity? Okay, so naturally, these kind of identities are problematized. That is why he's saying post-colonial literature tries to problematize the whole idea of nationality, and naturally post-colonialism is influenced by post-modernism. So post-modernism does not believe in any kind of fixity, and that is how the post-colonial literature, they try to, this kind of thing problematizes the whole idea by interrogating all these things.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Okay. Sir, there is Shivam Dixit. He wants to know that is hybridization good for culture and identity?
Now, this is a question whether it is, you see, when we talk about all these things, you know, good and bad are
yes.
moral categories.
Okay, exactly.
Moral categories. But anyway, I won't give you a personal answer to this. But what theoreticians try to say is that, you see, like, you know, the post-colonial theorists try to say that, yes, hybridization is something which is not good in that sense, but it is a creative kind of a phenomenon. Okay, hybridization is creative. Why? Because you are not in hybridization, you are not restricted to only a single parameter. You borrow things from many sources. So when you borrow things from many sources, naturally you are eclectic and naturally you are enriched. Okay, so borrowing things from other different cultures is very enriching. So when it is enriching, you become more creative. But if you are not hybridized and you believe something called purity, so purity in that sense is actually a myth. And even if it is not a myth also, then what happens is that if you borrow, you don't borrow anything and you just restrict to do one single thing, so naturally it will become stagnant. It will not grow. And that is how hybridization is very creative. I won't use the word good or bad in that sense because we are not in moral science classes.
Okay, sir, I have a question. Sir, you just said that our identities consist of hybridity. Yes. So if we say that the Britishers were the colonizers, sir, so we can say that their identities could be said that devoid of hybridity, or their identities could be said that they are exclusive towards their nation?
No, you see, we were colonized by the British, no doubt. But the what I can get from your question is this, that you are trying to ask that are, British. Can you please repeat what actually?
Sir, what I want to know is that our identities are very much, hybrid, consist of hybrid cultures. But, if we can, try to interpret the identities of the Britishers, we can say, they are not, they do not consist. They do not have that post-colonial crisis. Do not have that colonial hangover that we go through. So we can say that they are very much, towards their, they are very much into their, towards their, devoted towards their nation, just like you said.
If you look at the British culture itself, you will find
yes.
that even the British, the so-called British culture is again a product of many streams. In that.
Okay.
It's even the English language, which they pride themselves, is actually is a product of many languages, old French and all these things, the history of English.
Old language, German.
Huh? The German, all those things. Even their culture is also in the Celtic and all those things. They're all mixed in that sense. Okay. So they also do not have any kind of a fixed kind of a pure kind of an identity. No culture has a pure kind of no culture is identity. For example, what defines our identity? Our food, our clothing, these are all our part of culture. You see, in India, for example, what we pride ourselves as Indian food is hardly Indian. We call jalebi our Indian food. But jalebi is not an Indian food. It is borrowed from somewhere else. So they are all got mixed up somewhere. So naturally, even the British, so when the Britishers came in contact with us, we in fact got enriched, because through their contact, we also got to have cultures which they had inherited in that sense. This is how we get enriched day by cultures. Okay. Even our own identity is not only our identity is there in Hinduism, Sikhism, but even the colonizers' identity is also a part of our identity. We are so much British. You see, I'm wearing a coat, for example, which is typically a British apparel, for example. But I'm very comfortable with it in that sense. Okay, so this is a part of our identity. My academic, the language that I speak in academia is English. Okay, so and I'm not very ashamed also too. People are ashamed of it that, Matribhasha, Onachi and all those things. I'm not ashamed of this. I use English comfortably as any other language, because that is a part, this is the colonizer's identity which has become a part of my identity. Part. And I am a mixed in that sense, that is hybridization.
Okay, thank you, sir. Any more questions?
Rashi, can you ask Andalip's questions? I think they are being covered in the lecture, perhaps.
Yes. Yes.
Is there anything to be asked from her side? Please ask. Because by, you know, it's hard luck that she couldn't be there in the lecture.
Yes. Sir, could you explain the difference between post-colonial and decolonial thinking?
Okay. Now, as such, the word, there is no such word like decolonial, like post-colonial in the sense. There is a word called decolonization and decolonized in that sense. Okay. Decolonization and decolonization is a process. Okay. Decolonization is a process where you try to get rid of the, let's say, the colonial heritage. Okay. For example, if you read the essay by Gugi Wathiongo called Decolonizing the Mind, for example, where he tries to say that the colonial rule has colonized our mind. That means we have started thinking like the colonizers. So there is a way to get rid of it. And that is what we call decolonization. Post-colonial, in that sense, has different meanings altogether. Post-colonial can refer to a particular period that, you know, that after colonization, what has happened. Okay, that is post-colonial in that sense, the hyphenated. Okay, and also post-colonial also becomes an ideology in that sense. Okay, that post-colonial in the sense that although we have, although the British, all the colonizers have left us, okay, and yet we still, let's say, have those structures, the colonial structures, which has become a part of us. So post-colonial has to do with negotiating with those heritage that the colonizers has left us. Okay. Decolonization is a process by which we try to get rid of those things and problematize those colonial heritage, which has become a part of us. We need not always, you know, throw away, but to we try to cope with them. That is how the decolonization. This is what.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Okay. Seema ma'am, should I ask one more question? Or,
yes, definitely. You can just ask. If it is only one, please ask, then we can wind up the session.
Yes, sir. Sir, how can we define the term post-colonial with special reference to Indian drama?
Drama. Okay. There is a... let's say many plays have come in Indian drama, which are labeled as post-colonial drama. Okay. So Mahesh Dattani. Mahesh Dattani's Final Solutions, if you read. Okay. Very interesting play. Okay. That, this is an example, which is a typical example of a post-colonial drama. Okay. Why post-colonial drama? Because it tries to address issues, okay, which has emerged because of colonialism. Okay, and he tries to show, one is that, you know, communal violence. Okay, communal violence, one of the very interesting aspect of post-coloniality is the whole idea of communal violence. And communal violence is a product of what colonization is all about. And Mahesh Dattani tries, in Final Solutions, tries to explore and dissect the causes and the repercussions and the effect of colonial violence in a post-independence situation. Okay, and tries to, and if you read the play, you will find that the roots of many communal violence lies in the colonial period. Okay, so by addressing the issues like communal violence, okay, let's say many other issues, for language issues, okay, gender issues. So these issues, all these things, when they try to address, which are product of colonialism, that is what we call post-colonial drama is all about. Okay, so we have ample of, you know, even let's say Girish Karnad is post-colonial in that sense. Why? Because if you read Tughlaq, for example, Tughlaq is a very interesting play. It is a typical post-colonial play. Why? Because although it is about a king who was like pre-colonial, but the issues about power and how power works is a typical example of, you know, post-coloniality, that how power works. Okay. And that's why it is a post-colonial drama. So post-colonial drama tries to deal with issues like power, hierarchy, okay, violence. And when these issues are dealt in this drama, it is called a post-colonial drama.
Okay, so thank you so much, sir.
I think there is no more question.
No, ma'am.
Okay. So I think with the permission of our head, we can just come to the customary vote of thanks now.
Sure, Seema, we can wind up now.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. And with due permission to you, let me just take in this opportunity to welcome one more jewel from the Department of Gorakhpur University, DDU Gorakhpur University, Dr. Sunita Murmu, who happens to be the wife of Dr. Professor Behra. So let me welcome her because she is constantly with us in this lecture. And now, on behalf of ELAN, that is English Literary Association of Navyu, and Department of English, Navyu Kanya Mahavidyalaya Lucknow, let me take this opportunity to thank Professor Dr. Gaur Hari Behra. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Yohanshiya. Nice
welcome,
to meet you.
Ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
And thank you for being here.
Thank you. Thank you. It's a pleasure being with you all.
Thank you so much.
We are honored by your presence, ma'am. And I think I'm audible to all of you. And so let me go to the customary vote of thanks once again. And first of all, it was really an enlightening and enriching experience for all of us, the participants, the students, as well as the faculty members. Some other college professors also are with us. It's a proud privilege that Professor Gaur Hari Behra's lecture was really an enlightening experience for all of us. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for giving us your precious time with us for an hour. It was really well organized, well in time, and beautiful presentation. Thank you. We are really honored by your presence on
this
platform,
of course,
digitally.
Thank you very much for listening to me with such patience. Okay, it was really a nice experience. Okay, so thank you very much once again.
And let me take this opportunity to thank our principal, Dr. Shrishti Srivastava, who has been really a very great source of inspiration throughout. From the very beginning, in her busy schedule, she takes time to be present throughout the whole, lecture, from the first lecture itself. And she takes very good interest also. That is really an inspiring and motivational thing for all of us from the Department of English. I take this opportunity to thank her really heartily. Thank you so much, ma'am. And thank you, our very pleasing personality, Dr. Sangeeta Kotwal, our head of the department, who is very enthusiastic and supportive in all these organizing these kind of things and supports us, stand with us. And without her support, it is not possible for organizing this kind of things. Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you all the participants over here, the professors from other colleges and the students as well from Gorakhpur, as well as I think some faculty from Gorakhpur also are there from other colleges. I have seen into the participant list. So I thank everyone. I thank everyone heartily and very, very good evening to all of you. Let's hope that we are meeting once again. And in Bangla, we say, Abar Ashchi.
So,
Ashbu, how about that? Thank you. Thank you so much, everyone.
Okay. Thank you.
Bye, sir.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Bye.